angel?
Never heard of angels before.
They're the most beautiful creatures in the universe.
Most people know me as Bishop Veazey, but my real name is John Harmon. You can call me John. My strange life. I was carried by the current. A story like mine could not be imagined. I certainly was not born to be a prince of the church. My flock would come to me and would ask, "Is there life after death?" My answer was, of course, for those who look to the Lord Jesus as their Saviour. Then they would ask, "Is there a hell?" My answer was, for those that St. Peter thinks deserves it on the day of judgment. Occasionally they would ask, "Where are the dead who are waiting for judgment?" I would answer, "They are walking with us and all around us, as I am with you. It is common knowledge. We are in the time of last days and the coming of the Lord." My life has been long and eventful. Who could have guessed what I have seen and who I have shared this earth with? For it to be so, the Lord Jesus must have had a mission for me. I have seen many princes of England and served with God's hand, all of them. Born of a simple yeoman, William Harmon, and my good mother, here at Sutton Coldfield, in the year of our Lord, 1465. Our family comprised of my parents, brother Hugh, sisters Agnes, Amercia, and me. We were a happy family. All of us worked as children on the farm, helping with the animals and the harvest. When our work was done, we would roam the fields, woods, and lanes of Sutton. We would fish for trout in the Ebrook and visit the King's Chase to see the stags rutting in the autumn. We would walk to Newhall and play with the servants' children. Sunday was always church at St. Blaise, an archery practice demanded by the King for our father. We would all watch the men and cheer. You can see where they sharpened their arrows still. Uncle Veazey was the priest at St. Blaise. He would keep my brother and me after service and teach us reading and writing of the English. Lord Jesus took our father to his rest when I was six in 1471. It was hard working the farm for my mother and us afterwards. Uncle Veazey paid for a labourer to come and work for the farm. In the same year, we heard that King Henry VI had died in London. No one knows the reason. In the year of our Lord, 1482, when I was 17, Uncle Veazey visited our mother and said he wanted to send me to Magdalen College in Oxford. I would be a great man with God's help, and he said he would pay all expenses. He had no children of his own. We had no idea what this meant. Magdalen College was a magnificent building. It housed many rooms dedicated to learning. I made many friends and we would talk in our lodgings late into the night. My closest friends were Thomas Wolsey and Hugh Oldham and, like me, were of common birth. Thomas's father was a butcher in Islington. We were all ordained into the church. After a year of studying canon and civil law, we hear that the young prince has died and that his uncle Richard has been crowned King Richard III. No one knows what to make of this. There are terrible rumours mumbled by the common folk. Only a year after, we hear that Henry Tudor has returned from France, raised an army and killed King Richard in battle at Bosworth, and had himself crowned King Henry the 7th. There is great celebration with the birth of the king's son Arthur in 1486. Then in 1491, the queen provides the king with another son, Henry, for the succession to the throne. The kingdom looks secure from the strife that plagued the houses of Lancaster and York, resulting in the deaths of thousands. With God's help, I found my studies easy. The college was in need of teachers for the growing number of new fellows, and by 1489 I was a professor at Magdalen, when the college was visited by King Henry VII with his son Arthur, Prince of Wales. It was at the banquet that he engaged Wolsey, Hugh Oldham and myself in conversation. In the morning he commanded Wolsey and myself to attend his court in London. I was to attend to Queen Elizabeth of York's court as an adviser. It was beyond belief when I arrived at Windsor Castle. Truly, I was an instrument in the hands of Lord Jesus. I returned to Sutton in 1490 to celebrate the marriage of my sister Agnes to William Gibbons. It was a time of happiness and anxiousness because we had no dowry for Agnes. She came to him with nothing. After 6 years of advising the Queen, I requested to take my leave of her court. I explained that my uncle has died and named me as his successor at St. Blaise. The Queen persuaded King Henry to appoint me as Archdeacon of Barnstable. She said I would be wasted in Sutton. There is great unrest in the land due to the king's men squeezing taxes from the people, and the riots of 1497 resulted in the deaths of 2,000 Cornish folk. I continued to be busy in my diocese of the West Country, travelling by coach, sometimes by horse when the roads are bad, in all weathers. My flock came to me for words of comfort, the Lord's truth, and forgiveness of sins by the Mass and confession, as well as accepting payment for the Lord's indulgences and the relief of the time spent in hell. We hear in 1501, even in Sutton, that the young Prince Arthur has made contract to marry a foreign princess from a far country. She is called Catherine of Aragon. My friends at court tell me that King Henry hopes the alliance between Spain and England will make our lands in France more secure. There is great celebration in London, and I am called to witness the marriage in Westminster Abbey. The young couple are to spend their honeymoon at the great castle of Ludlow, as befits the Prince of Wales. Only weeks into their marriage, we hear that the prince has died at Ludlow of the sweating sickness that is rife in London. There is much consternation and unrest in the country. The succession is now uncertain. Will civil war break out when King Henry dies? Only 1 year later, in 1503, sad news arrives of good Queen Elizabeth's death in childbirth. The king was distraught for weeks. It is said he had a madness. What evil has befallen his reign? Has some sin been punished for taking the crown? We hear the king is consulting with both mystics and clerics for an answer. News arrives in 1509 that my friend from Oxford, Thomas Wolsey, has been appointed as chaplain to King Henry and attends him at Windsor Castle in his private chambers for confession. He is close to all of the royal family, particularly young Prince Henry. I pen Thomas a letter congratulating him. Within months, the Lord calls the king to him. Some say he died of a broken heart. Immediately I am recalled to London, and the new King Henry VIII appoints me as Canon of Windsor, replacing Wolsey, who is now a special counsellor to the 17-year-old king. Methinks Wolsey had a hand in this, I'm sure. I am now hearing the King's confession and delivering services in St. George's Chapel, Windsor Castle. The new king has learned well from his father and is suspicious of the nobles around him. So he appoints common men like Wolsey, Oldham, and myself to positions of power. Such is his suspicion of the barons and lords. The young king is growing into a picture of what a king should be. He loves jousting and the tournaments, much to the consternation of his council of advisers, of which Wolsey is president. The schooling he received stands him well in his Latin and other learnings, having been originally set for a man of the cloth. He is the most magnificent of all Europe's kings. He confesses to me that he aspires to regain the lands lost in France, but the time is not right. Then, in 1513, against Wolsey's advice, the king invades France. A costly war ensues, with disappointing results. The Scots come to the aid of the French as usual and invade the north of England. Queen Catherine raises a second army and rushes north to defeat them. Peace with France is seen to be important, and to this end, Wolsey suggests that the king's sister Mary be married to Louis, King of France. This would bond the two countries together. This is done, and peace and prosperity prevail. England and France now face a common threat, the Muslim Ottomans. Hastily, Wolsey uses his new influence to conclude a joint defence treaty with France, the Treaty of London. Wolsey, in 1515, has a lavish palace built that befits a cardinal, sited outside the filth of London, in the country at Molesley, by the River Thames. He can travel to it in comfort by barge. My friend, the lawyer and Member of Parliament, Thomas More, who I know from my Oxford days, has the famous Erasmus staying at his home again in London during 1516. Thomas met him while on a trade mission in Brussels, directed by Wolsey. Erasmus has read and influences the manuscript of a most interesting treatise authored by Thomas to be called Utopia. It is a new way for men to live together as citizens of equal stature. Due to its radical nature, it is to be printed in the good Catholic town of Luan in Belgium. When I read the treatise, it is so radical and yet borrows much from the Roman and Greek republics. Can men, ordinary men that is, rule themselves without a lord or king? Can elected officials really administer without strife the lives of their fellow men? He suggests that all men of the realm receive an annual stipend from the royal coffers. It even suggests that women could be priests. Truly such radical thought is astounding to the common man. 1516, and Queen Catherine delivers a girl child, Mary. Good King Hal is a wise ruler with Wolsey's help. The king leaves all government to Wolsey. Parliament is occupied by merchants and landlords who just talk among themselves and enrich each other at the expense of the common folk. Thomas More is now Speaker. Wolsey has, in his employ, a Thomas Cromwell, due to his ability to speak Italian. Wolsey wants an Italian marble tomb built. Cromwell has cruel eyes, maybe because he had been a soldier of fortune on the continent. Then, a year later, we hear that a priest called Martin Luther has issued a proclamation that the Holy Catholic Church is corrupt and an abomination in the eyes of God. How can such things be tolerated? 1519, we hear that our friend Thomas Oldham has died unexpectedly while Bishop of Exeter. I am summoned to the presence of the king and invited, nay, commanded, to take the appointment of Bishop of Exeter. Again, I feel that Wolsey had a hand in this, or is he directed as an instrument of our Lord? The king awards me £1,450 a year stipend. His hunting lodge in Newhall, Sutton. And the great deer chase of 2,700 acres at Sutton. I am overwhelmed, but graciously accept. One does not upset the king. At last we can assuage the dishonour of no dowry for Agnes, and I give Newhall to my brother-in-law, William. My new living in Exeter is most grand. The cathedral is second to few in all the world. Look, here is poor Hugh's tomb. It is very grand. God let his soul rest in peace. I travel extensively, ministering to my flock, delivering God's word and selling indulgences for the forgiveness of sins and the relief from hell. The following year, sad news arrives from Sutton. My sister Agnes has died. I have returned to Sutton to comfort my mother and assist with the arrangements with my brother Hugh and my brother-in-law William. I'm surprised when I see the condition of the inhabitants. I had forgotten the meanness of their living. My mother has lost her daughter and husband. She is not well. Wolsey has done it again. To reaffirm the Treaty of London in 1520, there is to be a glorious event in France. It is called thereafter the Field of the Cloth of Gold. Both kings and queens, 5,000 nobles and courtiers, each from England and France, now meet to conclude the peace treaty. To make sure there is no trouble between the two sides, the French King Francis has made special arrangements. Over the 2 weeks of the festivities, the kings and nobles of each side will be entertained by the other's queen and ladies. Queen Claude of France is heavily pregnant and declines to dance with King Hal. She sends one of her ladies-in-waiting to dance with him. He is much taken by her charms, if you know what I mean. She spoke perfect English, as well she should. Your historians will tell you that the king met Lady Anne Boleyn when she returned to London after being in the French court. I'll give you the real story, as whispered to me by Wolsey at the dance. Wolsey was approached by Sir Thomas Boleyn for a quick answer to a problem. He had two daughters. One of them at 15 had carnal knowledge of not only his butler, but also his chaplain. If the scandal got out, she would be ruined. Wolsey arranged for her to attend the court of the Duchess of Austria in Brussels, out of the way. Now King Hal had arranged for his sister Mary to marry the then French king Louis XVII. Anne was appointed by Wolsey to be one of Mary's ladies-in-waiting, along with her sister Mary Boleyn. Why? Because she now spoke French. King Hal paid all of the expenses, and no one could guess the consequences of this meeting. The marriage lasts only months when King Louis dies. He is succeeded by Francis, who is already married. Queen Mary has no issue and is sent back to England with the ladies-in-waiting, except Lady Anne Boleyn, who is retained by the succeeding queen, Claude. It is not surprising that only 2 years later, in 1523, my mother dies. Again, I return to Sutton, and the people are in a dire condition. Again, I return to Sutton. And the people are in a dire condition. My brother tells me that often the people in winter do not have enough to eat, and children are called to the Lord early in their lives. Poor Wolsey. He loses his attempt to become Pope to the French King's old tutor by only 6 votes. How things would have been different in England if he had become Pope. Then Parliament passes legislation to break with the Pope as the supreme head of the true Catholic Church, but if not the Pope, who? While the Church is strong, the monasteries are turning to decay. By 1524, Canwell Abbey, a few miles from Sutton, has become deserted, a comment on the local community it served. Many arrive with cart to take away the valuable stone. I manage to save the abbey bell and donate it to the Holy Trinity Church in Sutton. It is a fine bell and complements the 4 existing ones. There are rumours in 1525 that King Hal is becoming impatient with the Queen, that still there is no male heir to secure the succession. Civil war could break out again between the nobles without one. That Boleyn woman is brought back by Wolsey to pacify a title dispute between the Boleyns and the Stanleys. He wants her to marry one of the Stanley's sons, but this does not happen. She is considered by other possible suitors, but her reputation follows her. The king has seen her again at court, acting in a play, and she is already a lady-in-waiting to Queen Catherine. God's hand moves again in 1526. By the king, I am now appointed to be president of the Welsh Council of Marches at Ludlow Castle. I will be the senior judge of all trials to be held in 2/3 of Wales, Shropshire, Worcestershire, and Warwickshire. I will be assisted in the King's justice by 20 good men. Crimes and disputes are decided by the court of all sorts of villainy, wrongful enclosures, all the way to murder. Good King Hal has given me the responsibility of the guardianship of Princess of Wales, Mary, at Ludlow. She is to be taught kingship by myself and tutored in the arts of statesmanship, even though she is only 9 years old. She attends the council many times and listens to the proceedings intently. How little could I know that having her in my care for 3 years would impact on my future. I am troubled for my place in heaven when I have to pass sentence of death for murder and other crimes. I solve this by taking confession from the accused in their cells prior to court appearance. In court, I listen with my head bowed, then face them, eye to eye, for the judgment. Many are struck dumb with their eyes staring when they recognize me. I visited Wolsey by his invitation at his palace in Molesey. He has named it Hampton Court. We arrive by his barge from London. It is most impressive. He tells me of how the construction provided employment for the local common folk, and how the skilled masons taught the local men their craft. Wolsey confides in me that the nobles are circling like wolves, envious of his power and wealth, and despising his low birth. He advises me to be careful and prudent. They poison the king's ear, he says. This made me think of Moore's Utopia and of Sutton's inhabitants. 1527. Work has started on my Moor Hall in Sutton, to be my palace after I bought 40 acres of land. Now the king will have somewhere appropriate to stay when he visits the chase, hunting the deer, here in Sutton. At Ludlow, there is an ancient boys' grammar school dating back to the time of the Crusades. I decide to follow Hugh Oldham's actions in Manchester before his death and have a new one built in Mill Street, Ludlow. I will also found a boys' grammar school in Sutton while Moore Hall is being built. Some ask if there is a connection with the hall's name and Sir Thomas More, but I keep my counsel. Good King Hal favours me, I know it. God must be moving in him. Does the holy anointing oil at his coronation give him a direct link to God, like the Jews' King David? In discussion with the king, I mention the good people of Sutton and their hardships. We talk about More's book, Utopia. The king declares, let them rule themselves, as prescribed in Utopia. See to it, Vesey. On the king's command, I prepare a statute declaring that Sutton is a royal town in perpetuity, to be ruled by a warden and 23 good men, elected by the residents on an annual basis. Good King Hal signs the statute and affixes his royal seal. It is done. By popular demand, I am elected the first warden. Other friends and relatives accept the nomination for the 23 good men of the townsfolk. The warden and aldermen need to meet somewhere in the town. My first act is to order the building of a moot hall close to Holy Trinity in the centre of the town. It has an arched market area below and a meeting hall above. There is also a jail. It is finished in 1529 to much acclaim. This is a fine start. The dwellings of the townsfolk are mean and impoverished, being wattle and daub with a thatched roof. The roof has a simple hole in it to allow the smoke of the cooking fires. Most unhealthy. Wolsey invites me to London in 1529 on a matter of great urgency. He wants me to sign and affix my seal on a letter to Pope Clement VII requesting the annulment of King Hal's marriage to Queen Catherine on dubious biblical grounds. Wolsey is most convincing in his argument. I reluctantly sign. Here is the letter with my seal and signature at the end. It fell on deaf ears. Pope Clement is the prisoner of Emperor Charles V of Austria. He has already sacked Rome. The king sees the rejection as a personal insult, one that lies at Wolsey's feet. Lady Anne and the king are openly romancing each other. It is said in court that she will not let him know her unless they are married, unlike her sister Mary. Oh, how can this happen? The same year, a special court is held to decide on the validity of Catherine and Henry's marriage. I am one of the judges. Queen Catherine puts up a spirited argument and does not accede to the king's demands. But the verdict goes against her by a hair's breadth. Her refusal to comply to the king's will causes great consternation in her homeland of Spain. No good will come of this. In 1530, I contract the building of 51 fine stone houses for the local folk of Sutton. They will be rented at a fixed, affordable rent. This money will be partly used to pay the wages of the grammar school master and other works needed in the town. Ah, I see that a few have survived the last 500 years. In the winter, by the fords with the rivers in spate, it is difficult for me and other fellow travellers to cross the River Tame of Sutton, and also the River Teme at Ludlow. The Abbot of Burton-upon-Trent had a stone bridge built for his monks to cross the River Dove to the fields where they worked. That's it, on the left. See the difference in the brickwork? I had two fine bridges built over the Teme and the Tame. You can still see the bridge at Water Orton and the footings of the Teme River Bridge at Ludlow in the summer when the water is low. While in London, we hear of the King of Sweden's confiscation of all lands and property of the true Catholic Church. This is the Lutheran doing. Wolsey has fallen victim to the wolves and lost the favour of the king. Some say that even gifting Hampton Court to the king has not pacified his anger. It is common talk at court that Sir Thomas Boleyn swaggers around while his daughter screams to the king of Wolsey's failure to get his marriage to Queen Catherine annulled. He is stripped of his positions and given the Archbishopric of York. He is barely settled when he is summoned to London to face trial for treason. He dies on the journey there, a broken, sick man, and some say by his own hand. Surely not. God rest his soul. The king's obsession with Lady Anne Boleyn continues through 1532. He is like a lovesick bull. She still will not let him know her, it is said. Then the pair travel to Calais, seeking the support of King Francis for their marriage. No one knows what exchanged, but Francis is won over. Copies of Niccolo Machiavelli's The Prince circulate the court in the same year. It is written in Italian, that Cromwell can read. It advises all princes to rule through fear, not love. There is a perceptible change in the king. Then, in 1533, Henry marries Lady Anne in London. Bishop Cranmer officiates and declares it valid. I look on the new queen in resignation. The common folk are unhappy with the good Queen Catherine's treatment. This is suppressed with the talk of treason if you speak about it. It was with some disappointment that the new Queen Anne delivers a girl child to Henry. She is named as Elizabeth after his mother. There is hope at court that the next child will be a boy. The church in Sutton needs to be extended, and I contract to add two fine aisles. They are finished in 1533. I'm getting too old for all this horseback travelling to Ludlow, Exeter, London, in all weathers. At 69, the comforts of my fires at Moor Hall call me, and I ask the King to allow me to retire as the President of the Welsh Marches. Everything has changed. Even the King has to be addressed now as Your Majesty, not Sire. The king selects Bishop Thomas Cranmer to be the first Archbishop of Canterbury, and I officiate at the consecration. It is a grand event, but some are unsure of its significance following the break from Rome. Then Cranmer confides in me at Christmas 1534 that the king is tired of Queen Anne's tempers, sulks, miscarriages. He asks, is there some way to get rid of her? The county is in a state of unrest only 2 years after my retirement from Ludlow. Thomas Cromwell continues Wolsey's work of dismantling the lesser monasteries and selling off the land. The monks are given a pension and left to their own devices. The local people are deprived not only of spiritual care, but the many benefits the monasteries provided. It is said that 20,000 protested in what became called the Pilgrimage of Grace. The king blamed Cromwell and said it would stop, and it did for a few months. In 1534, Sir Thomas is arrested due to refusing to swear an oath of succession, not repudiating the Pope, and not accepting the annulment of Henry's marriage to Catherine. He is executed a year later for treason by beheading. It seems to many that the king is following Niccolo Machiavelli's foul advice. His friends and I collect £1,000 in tribute for the family. His daughter, Margaret Roper, has his head taken down from the spike on London Bridge. See, here it is in St. Dunstan's Church, Canterbury. Then we hear that Queen Anne and Thomas Cromwell have stand-up arguments in front of the king over all things finance and foreign policy for the country. She has said that Cromwell is giving the king bad advice to further his own riches. What is a woman doing meddling in such matters? Amazingly, we hear that Queen Anne has been arrested and is being tried for treason. The charge is adultery. At her trial, she puts up a spirited defence, but her history with the butler and her father's chaplain becomes common knowledge. Methinks Wolsey must have mentioned this to Cromwell. We are all aware of the trial's outcome before even the end. Worst of all, she has failed to provide the king with the promised male heir. She is beheaded only days after. The unrest boils over in Ireland with rebellion against the crown. Common folk are tried for treason and executed. Great rejoicing in the land. In 1537, a boy is born to the king by Queen Jane, Prince Edward. The bells ring out throughout the land. The king's reign is secure. In 1542, misfortune follows misfortune, as all the remaining monasteries are taken by Cromwell. The lead from the roofs are melted down, the land is sold off, and the stone is sold off. Some buildings are turned into homes for the rich who pay pennies to Cromwell. Oh, woe! Good King Hal dies in 1547. Much has changed, some say for the worse, during his reign. Prince Edward is crowned king by Archbishop Cranmer at Westminster Abbey. He is now Edward VI. He is only 6 years old. Cranmer claims the king's authority comes directly from God. Is he a man like others, or a demigod? What does this mean for England? The country is governed by the Council of Nobles, headed by Edward Seymour, Duke of Somerset. To everyone's surprise, a new common prayer book is authorised in 1549. There are changes that some don't like from the true Catholic prayer book. It causes riots. Over 900 good English men are killed in the suppression. God rest their souls. We hear that the now 13-year-old King Edward is in conflict with his older sister Mary. He directs her to renounce the true Catholic Mass. She disobeys him. Her chaplains are imprisoned one after the other. He directs her to stop dancing. She disobeys. He expels her from London to a remote house at Hunston, then Kennington, and then to another country house. There is better news at Christmas 1550. The king and his two sisters, Mary and Elizabeth, meet up in London and seem reconciled. The new year of 1551 brings bad tidings. The king is continuing to pursue his ambitions with vigour of removing all the last vestiges of the true Catholic Church. He replaces many bishops, including me, with men who will do his bidding. I am divested of my living of the bishopric of Exeter and have been reduced to one-third my annual stipend. God save the king. There is further turmoil when, in 1552, another prayer book is issued without the icons of the cross, so the priest has to remember to cross himself in the service. The young king goes on a great progress to the country with his courtiers, 4,000 of them. It does not last long, as the great houses cannot accommodate such numbers. I am not invited. It seems the king has no money. His father has squandered the fortune his grandfather amassed on wars, forts, ships, soldiers, and banquets. Again, trouble arises when the young King Edward dies unexpectedly in 1553, aged only 15. He has named Lady Jane Grey as his heir to await the maturity of his sons. Princess Mary rushes to London and gains the throne with the support of the council. Immediately, the old bishops are reinstated, me included, as the Bishop of Exeter. I have the honour of being the only man to achieve this twice, even now. Only a year into Queen Mary's reign, Parliament reinstate the punishment of heretics. 200 souls are publicly burned at the stake. Is the end time here already? Will I be tried next? I am now a very old and sick man. My hands are just claws with infirmity. No longer can I hold a quill. I shake and spill the ink from my pen. My memoirs are complete. I hear St. Peter's whisper, "V.C., where are you? V.C., where are you?" Well, I am here.